All right, ready? Well.
Attention. The movie guys love movies. Any jokes about the death of self-help guru Dr. Wayne Dyer are purely for entertainment purposes only.
Wait, now you're positive he's dead?
Yes, I'm positive.
Well, I'm sure you'd be happy to know that we're thinking positively.
Is that the guy that was on Stern a lot? Was he on Stern?
No.
Who was that?
Dr. Wayne Dyer wrote Your Erroneous Zones.
And Pulling Your Own Strings and How to Get What You Really, 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 Really Want.
I pull my own erroneous zones. Is
I'm
that
sure
wrong?
You do.
I combine those two books.
If you know what I mean.
He actually was quite great. We goof.
He's great.
Because he was a relatable dude.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and he talked about the cosmos and, you know, quantum physics and all that, but in a way that was just like, I want this and here's how I can get it. And not, you know, like trying to be smarter than thou or being too much of a, you must have me in your life every day to get everything.
Yeah.
You know, like he could say, here's some shit to know. I'm going to back off.
He didn't
you
have a newsletter I could subscribe to on a daily basis?
He might have had that, but he didn't have a late night infomercial.
No, okay.
So imagine all those guys that like say you can get whatever you want, but without you take all the creepiness out and all the kind of weirdness and you're like, and just have a lovely old man. He's like that.
I'm going to tell you the secret to happiness in 327 installments over the course of 12 years.
Yeah, well, to give you an idea, his lectures were on PBS, so that gives you the idea right there.
No profit motive. I always love that basically Tony Robbins, the only thing he really can teach you in order to make money is to teach what he's doing, is to, like, become a late-night infomercial guy. It's the only way to make his money. You just think positively and do all that.
Up until I found Wayne Dyer when I was, like, he came into my life, like, when I was 19, my cousin started reading his stuff, and he gave me...
3 years ago?
Yes, 3 years ago. Thank you, Bart. You're my favorite movie guy ever. My cousin gave me the book, Erroneous Zones, and I read it. And then I read Pulling Your Own Strings. And I got to tell you, that was the first time in my life I ever came up with the concept. I ever heard the concept that you don't have to feel guilty about everything and you don't have to worry.
Wait.
Someone has to
tell
you
feel guilty
stuff
about
at some
everything?
Point.
Yeah. No, I felt guilty about everything, worried about everything, because that's how my family dealt with everything. So I thought that showed you care.
The only way you know how to
only way you
it.
Know how to do it is if you worry. And then whenever he wrote on there that you don't have to worry, like anything's going to happen anyway, I was like, fuck.
Yeah.
I was like, well,
wait
right.
a minute. If you're not worrying
what?
About it, then you might not be thinking about it.
Right?
And then that doesn't work.
Oh, it was so amazing.
Oh, wait a minute. I think I see.
I'm inspired to do the show now.
Okay.
See?
Let's do it.
Welcome
let's
to the movie showcast,
nice.
Everybody.
Do the shit out of this show.
Part of the vast and sprawling movie guys empire. Ned, I would love to stand here and talk with you, but I'm not going to. You've reached ground zero for all things movies and comedy. We bring the two together right here on our show every week with jokes, rants, sketches, characters, bits, banter, special guests, and more as
That's
we broadcast.
That's what just happened there. It was banter.
As we broadcast from the Admiral's Club in the heart of Burbank Airport's flyover zone. They don't stop making movies, so we don't stop making comedy shows about movies, which means you can get a new show every week at themovieguys.net, as well as iTunes, SoundCloud, Stitcher, Vimeo, YouTube, Player.fm, TuneIn, poddirectory.com. That's a new one. Absolutely free. And we encourage you, please, subscribe. Periscopians watching and the folks who are going to watch on Vimeo.
Yeah, if you're listening to this after the fact, because we posted on Thursdays and Fridays, if you actually want to see it live, you won't hear any of the cues for the sound and stuff. But you can just tune in this time on Wednesday nights and see it live.
And that is about 8:30 Pacific.
Mm-hmm.
So if you got your late night shenanigans, you know, you're nodding off to sleep, we'll help.
And I'm a fan of us, but I have to say, you start rolling in about 15 minutes before we start.
Yeah,
it's hilarious.
So
we're charming as shit.
At least Adam is.
I know I am.
So listen, all that stuff, wherever you are, iTunes or any of the social media, like, subscribe, share, post.
And sometimes Karen takes her shirt off.
Depending on how many Periscope viewers. If we get 100, I take my shirt off.
Well, now you're going to stick around. Subscribe. Oh, my God. You will regret saying that.
You will regret it. I will not, however.
We're also on WBAD.net Fridays at 4 p.m. Eastern. Basically, just search the movie guys on Google, Yahoo, or...
Bing!
And we come right up. I'm your host for the hardest working comedy show in the airwaves, Paul Preston, here with Bart Caius.
Pain don't hurt.
And Karen Volpe.
That gal's got entirely too many brains to have an ass like that.
And Adam Witt.
Look, Maude, I'm sorry that your stepmom is a nympho or whatever.
Joining us in the second half of the show is another real movie guy who for 7 years championed indie film on the website filmsnobbery.com. Mm. We'll get him in here and find out what he's up to nowadays. Nick LaRue will
Yay!
Be here.
Yeah.
Nick LaRue.
So today on the show, we'll get you caught up with the movie news, and we'll do what we do best, and that's preview. The new release is coming to theaters this Labor Day weekend. Traditionally, the end of summer. But with summer starting sooner and sooner, this is our third week of dull post-summer movies.
I blame global warming for summer starting sooner and, or ending sooner and sooner.
Including the Transporter Refueled, just in time to take advantage of the Labor Day drop in gas prices.
Right.
And A Walk in the Woods, a charming tale about a couple of old guys that get lost wandering in the woods. Or as we call it in our house, Grandpa Forgot to Take His Medicine.
I'm tired of life being all about ailments and funerals. I want to push myself.
You want to hike the Appalachian Trail?
2,000 miles?
No, you have gone mad.
It's my old puppy.
Say no more, say no more.
It's the perfect place for you to spend the night.
Perfect place for you to spend the night. She just has that tone, doesn't she?
Oh, Emma Thompson?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Love her.
She can whip off a line.
It's like chock full of Academy Award winners and nominees. It's almost too much of a good thing. I'm a little trepidatious about
it. Who directed
this.
It? I don't even know.
A guy.
We're supposed to be providing this information. I have no clue.
Whoever directed all those Diane Keaton
Nick
movies that come out this time of year, usually.
That's Nancy Myers, who's doing the Robert De Niro movie.
Oh, okay.
Which I cannot wait to see. That's going to be fantastic.
Yeah.
The Intern?
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see De Niro just go straight funny again. It's been a while since I analyzed this, right?
Yep. Was that the last one?
We'll analyze that, but did that really happen?
Yeah. We mean both. It's like Star Wars. You mean all three.
But it's funny you mention all the names who are involved in this movie. Yeah. And you know, and I'll play it again. I hear Robert De Niro, Nick Nolte, Emma Thompson. I just wouldn't expect it to start like that, the trailer. You know, hey, we're having fun. And it's, yeah, I would expect it to be, you know, quite serious. And maybe they learn more than the walk in the woods.
Not going to happen.
Looks like you're going to have a blast dodging deer and whatever.
No, this movie has the most positive music. Like every music cue in it is like, oh.
Yeah. Well, you know how I've said before that I like movies where
Diamonds and Souls for their shit.
I like movies where my hero is never in danger of ever losing.
Of course.
Like Jack Reacher just wins the whole time. This movie is like the old person equivalent of that, of just there's never going to be any real trouble. It's just going to be nice and fun and everyone's going to get along and life's going to be great.
I like that. Usually in these things, like, and along the way, they learn a little bit about life. Nope. They start learning about life right away. I'm into that.
And it's fun lessons. There's no real trial or tribulation.
Right, we'll get to that later. Ed, but those of you who might be new to the Movie Showcast, we should tell you we're not like other shows. We don't cover a lot of movie news going on in extensive paragraphs about the boners we have for this or that casting choice for a comic book character. Mm-hmm. We're a comedy show that loves movies. But every now and then, we do feel the urge to cover movie news in a little segment we like to call The Latest.
It's been a while.
Why that? I don't know.
It's been a while.
We need to have a theme off and play all of them and see which one's the best. That might be the best.
All right, what's shaking and baking in Hollywood? Let's round table it, shall we? Our first story. Last weekend's new Zac Efron movie, We Are Your Friends, posted the third worst opening weekend of all time for a major release of 2,000-plus screens, boasting a box office take of only $1.7 million. That's for the weekend. Thoughts, Karen?
We have no friends.
It seems that way. Bart?
You know, Paula, today's ticket prices, that means that every friend of Zac Efron saw this movie, and that's it.
Yeah. Hmm.
I thought he was popular. Adam?
Like I've said all along about this movie, you're no Oogie Loves in the Big Balloon Adventure.
Wow, you've managed to insult both movies at once. Discuss.
That's the second.
How
least,
do you put?
Right?
Actually, Oogie Loves is the worst.
Oh, that's, I'm sorry.
Yes,
that's,
the worst per screen ever. Delgo being second. So now We Are Your Friends, Zac Efron, led male star leading vehicle, only trumping Oogie Loves and Delgo.
It sounds like 2,000 screens is a lot. Is it a lot? It sounds like a lot, right?
Yeah. I mean, that puts it well beyond indie film, and this is a major studio release.
I'd love to know how much more popcorn profit was made on those screens than ticket. I bet you they made more money selling popcorn at 2,000 screens than they did this movie.
Things like...
For the movie that people saw.
Yeah. Things like Hoot. Remember Hoot?
Hoot.
Like that had 2,500 and it was a horrible disaster.
Yeah. And then what was that Wizard of Oz one that came out last spring or something? And
oh,
like a lawsuit.
That did not well.
Yeah, there was
that
like a lawsuit.
That didn't do
that.
Well. Yeah, but I can't remember what it was, and we talked about it on this show, and I couldn't tell you the name of that movie.
Here's a great
Dorothy's
thing.
Return.
Dorothy,
Revenge.
Yeah. No? Which it sounds like a weird, like... Sure. Don't they have, like, it's like a friend of Dorothy? Is that like an Alcoholics Anonymous thing? I don't know
that's
why that
title...
That's
for gay people.
That's gay people.
Oh, yeah. A friend of Dorothy. Okay,
what?
Yeah.
Please, wait. Please to explain, friend of Dorothy.
If you are a gay person, that's code.
Oh,
back
friend of
when
Dorothy.
You couldn't admit you were gay, 2012. You know, you would have to say things in code.
Friend of Dorothy.
All right, this just in, because this kind of tells you that. Okay, how many theaters? 2,000?
Yes.
It actually made it to the theater in my hometown.
No way.
So that's a lot of theaters.
That's a lot of theaters. Because if it's making it to my hometown, that's a lot of theaters.
It actually played in more theaters than Delgo and Oogie Loves. Yeah. It played in 2,300.
And also,
what you do with the title might be the problem here.
Paul also playing there is straight out of Compton.
In your hometown?
Yeah.
Wow.
Interesting.
There's a crazy motherfucker named Ice Cube in your hometown? From a gang called?
From a gang, yeah.
I just hope this doesn't affect Zach's career. It's been going so well lately.
Neighbors.
Listen to that. That's classic Bart Kai's like, fuck you.
Not jealous at all comments from Bart Kai's.
That's good. That's why we have him here.
Let's get on to the next story. Horror film legend, writer, producer, and the director of classic slasher films A Nightmare on Elm Street and Scream, Wes Craven, has passed away at the age of 76 of brain cancer.
It's
horrible news. I hesitate to throw horrible news to a panel of wise asses, but your thoughts, Adam?
Well, I mean, I'm going to take this seriously, but, you know, considering the endings to most of his movies, a lot of his fans are considering his ending to be a bit of a letdown.
Good point. Bart?
Well, Paul, he is going to make a great ghost.
Even better point. Karen?
Yeah, I just wonder, did he die in his sleep? Could somebody find out if he died in his sleep? And if he did, I think we know what happened.
Okay, we should know that. That should be released. True. Yes. Discuss.
Did he die in his sleep?
Somebody's got a type.
Who knows?
Because clearly.
Unmentioned in his, because in the news they can only mention a couple of them. Of course, they're going to mention Scream.
Sure.
Of course, they're going to mention Nightmare on Elm Street. Unmentioned Swamp Thing? You think Swamp Thing came up on CBS when they reported the...
Did he do Hellraiser?
No,
that's
who
not
was that?
That is
Clive Barker.
Clive Barker.
Did he direct that too, or
yes.
just wrote it?
Under a pseudonym, I think he did.
I feel like I'm underprepared for my directorial knowledge today.
Well, Wes Craven, we've got
We're
Last House
you.
On the Left.
Hills Have Eyes.
The Hills Have
and,
Eyes.
And here's the one that no one brings up. That's even stranger, I think, than Swamp Thing. Did he direct Swamp Thing?
Yes.
I'll be damned.
Absolutely.
Okay, so he directed the Meryl Streep, Gloria Estefan film, Music of the Heart.
That was terrifying. Absolutely terrifying.
Now, but it was a solid, small drama. And I thought, okay, he's transitioning. Next thing you know, he'll be doing, you know, like, bigger and better dramas. Nope, went back into horror. Like, he just did a one-off. I was surprised he didn't stick with it.
It was like a passion piece. I think that was right after Scream. He's like, all right, I got some juice. I'm going to go do my little drama type thing.
Yeah. It got Meryl another Oscar nomination. I think she's going to get one anyway.
He could
have been proud of that, hopefully.
Little known trivia, my stepdad worked for a screen printing company back when licensing...
That is very little known.
Not a lot of people know that.
Almost nobody knew this.
There was not a lot of licensing back then. They really didn't do that sort of thing where they would, like, you know, Marvel would make a huge deal with whoever. So, like, DC Comics, when Swamp Thing came out, just went to whoever, and it went to this little t-shirt shop in Brookville, Ohio, and he did the series of Swamp Thing t-shirts. I have the art of Swamp Thing and Arcane, which was the villain in that. A very cool
piece
of artwork.
Who would have gotten that today? Like some big...
Yeah, like they would be a part of the contract.
Champion or
something. Kmart would have marketed that underwear.
Yeah, exactly.
Was it just t-shirts or underoos? Swamp Thing underoos?
They didn't have underoos.
Because swampy underoos might not be a good thing.
Swampy
underwear?
Bart's in advertising.
I actually wonder if Swamp Thing has ever really ended up on any other clothing. Obviously, Batman, Superman, and Wonder Woman have been on hundreds and thousands of designs, but like Swamp Thing?
Well, it may happen.
Is that Sears right
Del
now?
Toro's working on the, what is it? What are they called? Dark Justice League?
Yeah. It's going to be good.
All right, our final story involves the ongoing discussion about who is going to be the next James Bond. Ooh. Well before the latest James Bond movie even hits theaters. One opinion that's been getting a lot of press comes from the current novelist of the James Bond series of books, Anthony Horowitz, who claims that Idris Elba is too street for James Bond. Provocative. Thoughts?
If that street is Piccadilly Circus, then he has a point. He's right on target.
Too much for that.
Yeah. Well, he's British. What gives? Adam?
Too street? I mean, are you sure he's not confusing Idris Elba with Wayne Brady? I mean, come on.
Yeah, Wayne Brady Street.
Indeed. Bart?
Actually, Paul, this is a big shame because I'd like to see James Bond order a Buckhorn 40-ounce malt liquor. Stirred, of course, not shaken.
I might be turning him around there. Thoughts?
Idris, this room has been going on
Why
forever.
Are they already casting a new James Bond?
Is
the current one broken? Does the current one not work?
No, he started bitching after Skyfall, right? Didn't
about what?
Craig Ferguson, what's his name? Daniel Craig?
It's not that. Daniel Craig.
I want to see that, though. I do want to see that because he's Scottish, which I think would piss off a lot of people.
Hey, Connery was Scottish.
Hey,
going back to what we're
going back.
All right, we're starting a petition after this show.
Craig Ferguson.
I want to make a point to start a petition after every
Craig
movie
Ferguson.
Guy show.
I wonder what Anthony Horowitz would think of that.
Yeah.
What was the Monty Python sketch where the Scottish poet McTeagle and every poem ended up with, could I borrow a couple bucks?
But what was Daniel Craig's beef?
I don't know. I don't get it. He's the best Bond ever. I heard him say these amazing series of movies.
Easy there, George Lazenby. Hold on.
Yeah, right. I mean, I guess it's just like, I don't know. He's just too comfortable in it and whatever. So it's time to bitch.
I haven't heard that, although I heard him say, you know, make the proclamation that either this or the next one would be his last. It must be this one, the way they're talking about having to get out there and recast.
Yeah.
It's such a tough call. I mean, I almost say go with a nobody because will Tom Hardy be charming enough? You know, will whoever...
You definitely want to go with a nobody. I mean, that's the thing. It's a surprise. It's like a... I don't know. It's like you don't go with a guy who's like had a huge movie career already or a huge TV career. It's
ooh,
like,
I haven't really thought about this. Who would be a really good next James Bond?
He's coming up now. He's playing a buddy to somebody
right
in a British
somebody from
movie
Game
right
of Thrones.
Now. Somebody from Game of Thrones.
Peter Dinklage.
The Transporter 2 guy.
You know, it's probably going to be a web video star.
Ooh, Paul Logan. Logan Paul.
Hey,
what's his
Adam, did you read the book?
That chick that cooks. She's on all the billboards now. She better be funny when I finally go look at that video, by the way. I don't know what her
name is.
She
won't be.
Yeah.
did you read the books?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Is it in there that he's white?
Yes.
Okay.
I mean, well, they say he looks like Hoagy Carmichael. I looked him up. That's a weird description. But, yeah.
That is weird.
I like the idea of Idris Elba. I think he's
British.
A good actor, and he's cute.
Yeah.
And
it
would be so different and cool.
Yeah, but he's already kind of played so many kind of, like, he's got a few iconic roles. What's that Netflix show?
He's the guardian of the gates of Asgard.
Well, there's Asgard.
I don't know. I think
it'd
be cool.
How could he possibly
cast
that
a different nationality? I think that's cool.
Luther is his big show.
Luther, that's right, yeah. And I don't know, you know, I mean, an Idris Elba type, but he's already so established. It's just not the way they always go with these things.
Ryan Gosling.
Nope. Too established.
No.
Yeah.
That's just, you said that
he's
out loud.
Boring.
Did you, where he
I'm
said
sorry,
that
was that up here?
Yeah, no. That was outside
that was
voice.
You could have easily said the word yummy the way you said that.
I want to do a retraction right away. I said nationality. I meant ethnicity.
Yes.
Sorry about that.
Absolutely. No. Not Welsh.
Because he's still British, so that doesn't make any sense.
Hey, well, we got female Ghostbusters, so I mean, what the hell?
Yeah.
Hey, you said as if the world were ending. What are you talking about?
It
no,
is,
I said it. I said it as if
living together.
I said it as if we can cross gender and race.
So we should have a female
lines.
Bond. So is that what you're saying?
Sure.
Not or should. Could.
We could.
Female bondage would be good.
Yeah, stunt casting would be a little
and
shit
we could
too,
still but. Keep the hot Bond girl. It would make it just that much more interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Karen with the last point.
That is some last word shit right there.
All right, enough movie news and on to this week's releases. Another weekend in September. Another arriving in theaters of two more chances to catch Straight Outta Compton or see Ant-Man again. Or I suppose, if you must... The Transporter Refueled.
Yes! Listen to the foretelling. Oh my god, this song is so good. I'm not even doing a bit.
This Mike Post?
What grade is this? It's gotta be
yes.
Mike Post.
Yes, it is. I can confirm. Yes.
By the way, kids, we're old. This is the shit right here.
Bart doesn't like to go too long without a few good men. Ed Wood. Or Hardcastle and McCormick
nice.
Reference.
Or Rockford Files.
Or Rockford Files.
I do like Rockford Files.
If Hardcastle is not available. All right, so anyway, Transformer Refuel. Like, I know the difference between a reboot and a remake, but a refuel?
Well, Paul, lest you think this film takes place entirely at a gas station or a fast food joint, fear not.
Oh.
This is still the high-octane saga of Frank Martin, the Transporter, a professional freelance courier driver for hire. When the package absolutely positively has to be there overnight, he'll kill you.
The Transporter is settled into a quiet life in the south of France. Out of the life!
Oh, good.
Never to go back.
No.
Ever.
Ever.
Ever. The only thing he transports these days is himself and his famous macaroni casserole to the retired badass hall to transport bingo numbers at the retired badass potluck.
I'm out of the life. Did you call B-14?
I'm out of the life, too. Bingo! A Wahlberg and Neeson for you. Jason Statham is not back as he fails to return to the big screen in an action spectacular so badass that could only come from Jason Statham or a guy that looks a little like him.
Let's hear you call Boris Karloff a cocksucker.
That's a bonus. I didn't even put that one in there. Wow. But when Fakin' Statham, oh, I'm sure I could look his name up, but what's the fun in that, gets a visit from his father played by the Punisher, okay, Ray Stevens, but the Punisher, he has to save his father, which is why the tagline exclaims, "This time it's personal." But every time you see that, you know that someone showed up late to the meeting and had to write their promo copy on the bus on the way over to the meeting.
Actually, you know what? I have it here. The character of Frank Martin will be played by...
The Rock, right? Paul, we're four movies in. It's time for Dwayne Johnson to join the franchise, right? That is how it works. Four movies in.
That's
no.
how it always works.
Perfect.
No?
It says here, Ed Skrine.
I mean, as soon as you think they can't come up with something, they come up with something else. Makes you wonder if guys like me will be out of a job. No. People will always need guys like me, right?
Guys like you. You mean an actor to take over a popular role in a movie franchise that's late in its years? Yep, we'll always need guys like you. Isn't that right, kid from Home Alone 3? Whatever his name is.
But don't worry. Everyone's favorite summer action star is back on the big screen. Audi! Following up their RS7 performance in Hitman Agent 47, this time Audi plays the S8, a 420-horsepower 4-liter V8 that really delivers an Oscar-worthy performance both on the track and your daily commute. In this role, it combines the refinements of a luxury sedan with the high-speed agility of a sports car, half its size. Now, whether you're a seasoned driver or just dropping the kids off at school on the weekend, you won't find a better combination of a...
Wait. Now, hold on a second. That's not the movie synopsis. I think you've started reading a sales brochure for the car or something.
No, Paul. That's actually the movie synopsis. I got that straight off of IMDb.
Well, you know, like they say, when promoting a movie, always highlight your star. So a good-looking guy with a cool car gets conned into driving some hot pussy around town while he bails her out of trouble at every turn. Sounds like a typical night in Hollywood. Isn't that right, Zac Efron?
Hot pussy? Is that the James Bond girl name in this one?
It is.
Now, before you get all judgy, thinking that there isn't going to be much more to this movie than just a bunch of fast driving and gunplay, I'll have you know that the transporter recycled...
Refueled
involves bank heists... Four hot Robert Palmer music video-esque blondes,
nice.
A sinister Russian kingpin, and a dangerous game of chess based on revenge.
And
fast driving and lots of gunplay.
There you go. I don't know. I like this better when it was called Smokey and the Furious Hitman Crank Taken Lucy Nikita Agent 47.
And I look forward to when the transporters actually become the cars in the next film, Transporters Age of Extinction.
Ooh. Oh, I would like to see that. Wait, so right now, cars become robots, but if cars could become transformers... Wait, transporters.
No, transporters.
Transformers become transporters.
Oh, that is a perfect crossover. He gets his next car is a transformer.
Oh, yes.
The transporter transformer. Transformer transporters.
Import-export, yes.
Yeah. There you go.
Import-export.
Oh, now we get the transporter informer.
That's amazing.
All right, enough of that.
That's amazing. We've made so many 90s references in this movie. I'm so proud of it.
I just want to say that whenever I think I need to go undercover, when I want to just kind of not be noticed, I always go for a platinum blonde bob wig.
Oh.
Because you blend right in.
Wait, those are wigs?
Three of them, yeah.
That's because you blonde right in. I'm just saying.
You blonde right in.
South of France, though. South of France.
Like, if I'm just kind of... go into the store and I don't want anyone there to see me without like makeup on or something, I just put on a blonde bob wig and no one notices
you. No one cares what you're up to.
Ever notice.
Yeah. No.
I like how these movies somehow found a style. I see this. This guy's a dipshit, right? This little skinny guy.
He's from Game of Thrones.
Yeah, I know. I think it's hilarious because
it's all skinny guys. Agent 47 was skinny guy too. We need. I'm up for some more big. You know.
Yeah, I want an action
brick shithouses doing action.
But I want an action star type to do my transporter
like
movie.
Like Idris Elba?
Like Idris? Oh, absolutely!
Right?
Now if they recast
be
Transporter, because there's no tradition for recasting that, because it's this may be the end of it. Let's face it. Isn't there a TV show that nobody watched?
Oh yeah, I think so.
Yeah,
or it's coming.
Yeah, there's a series. Yeah, there was a series.
No, it already came and went. Oops.
Yeah,
was folks. Did you realize there was a Transporter TV show?
Yeah.
There you go. So this is it.
But you know what's weird? Looking at global box office, Each one of these went up. Transporter 3 with Jason Statham cracked 100 million worldwide.
Yeah.
You know, that's that would be some movies do that domestically.
Yeah,
but this the
is
whole
like
world, but the one before that, 85, like the original Transporter only made about 43 million worldwide.
I think it
so they were kept getting good. I don't know why they he bailed. I don't know why he's not in, because all he made was some like straight to video thing called
Is he hit the big time doing Expendables 3?
No, wait a second. Furious 7 and Spy. He had a huge summer.
Yeah, but you can still do your Transporter movie.
He could. I agree. That's what I agree.
But this makes me feel good to know that his finances are all in order, because he clearly doesn't need the money.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
He does a movie like this, you go, oh, gosh, he must be hurting.
But the producers of this are like, oh, head screen. You're going to get paid $4 to pretend you're Jason Statham. I'll do it.
You had me at $4.
And not for nothing.
Oh, go ahead. Finish this up. I have something about We Are Your Friends.
Now's a good time.
That might be what we call a topic change. Hold on 1 second.
You go.
No, I was just going to say we have another farting trailer.
Oh!
All right. Karen concedes there are time to the floor.
It's my new favorite thing. Here we go. Here's the top of the trailer for the Transporter Refueled. It farts.
Excuse me. Hello?
Transporter.
Right away.
Excuse me.
I do love this shit though, right? I mean, this movie is everything it needs to be. Like, I watched the trailer and I'm like, I'm not really buying the skinny guy. But then all of a sudden he's having a fight in like a safety deposit room and he's like pulling things out, knocking people. Like, all the stylized action is super wonderful. It's like, it's ridiculous.
Right. We should stop. If we do it, we don't, though. I think we give Luc Besson his day in court. But if we don't, we need to stop, because they're not huge movies anymore that he's producing, but they're all solid.
They're solid.
He just makes Columbiana, 3 Days to Kill,
yeah.
The Taken. He just keeps putting out solid action movies.
And that was the
thing. They don't get too goofy.
Yeah.
You know, they're not weird. They stay on point with a serious message, and guys got to get shit done. All your rules are in effect. I know you love the Transporter. I did it again. The Transporter rules. They're in effect. They're on the poster again.
Oh, yeah.
Never change the deal. No names. Never open the package.
I love a guy with rules.
But the package is three hot blondes. Yeah. You can't open.
Nope.
How does he?
You can't open your package.
Okay. Can't open your package on the blonde.
By the way, I was looking up some information on this movie, and I found this guy online. I hate Rotten Tomatoes because they feature who? So-and-so from
Barnsdale Press.
Barnsdalepress.net. Like, somebody beat him to that, you know, whatever. But this is my favorite. I was looking up an online review, and this guy breaks what I just coined as the John Woo rule, okay? So the reviewer, whatever website he's on, he criticized a deluge of car chases, gun battles, and fist fights choreographed within an inch of their lives.
That's exactly what I'm
hoping.
What
are they supposed to do? Just be willy-nilly and people are supposed to die?
You are not allowed to be surprised at the number of doves in a John Woo movie.
Ugh.
That's on you, right? I just coined the term. That's boom, nailed it.
You're not paying attention.
Yeah, right? You don't know who John Woo is correctly. You don't know what the Transporter is in the right way. It's just a strange thing. It's like, you go to the Transporter, like, I'm surprised it wasn't a walk in the woods.
I can't believe I went to that. I went to that Barbra Streisand concert. She kept singing.
Oh, that's singing.
What a jerk.
You would shut her mouth.
All right, we're getting on to our next movie, but before we do, you have something?
Yes, I just realized what happened with We Are Your Friends, because it's a movie about people having friends in L.A. that are supposed to show up for things.
That's the best observation of all
time. Right? It just hit me.
It's the best. It is about a DJ in Los Angeles who is getting the big gig.
Nobody shows.
Here's the movie.
Oh my
Nobody
God.
Shows.
Everybody who's ever done a show, everybody says they're showing up. Everybody says they're showing up.
A month before this movie opened, everyone in LA, totally going to that.
RSVP'd. I'm going to that.
I'll be there.
Oh,
something better showed up, and they went to do that.
We have to look up the number of people who attended versus the number of people who liked its Facebook page.
Yes!
We have to find out that stat and whether Wes Craven died in his sleep. Write that down,
Paul.
Two
important things. Get on that.
All right.
Good.
Well, next up, A Walk in the Woods.
Oh.
The question most of you are probably asking is this a movie?
Why, yes it is, Paul.
Oh, that's good.
Not only is it based on a book, but it's based on a book about the author of the book. So this is a movie based on a book about the author of the book and featuring a character based on the author of the book that the movie itself is based on.
Woo!
You cannot get any more movie than that.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. I think we can move forward. Now, a walk in the woods, a retired travel writer is joined by a long-lost friend as the two attempt to hike the Appalachian Trail. It's grumpy old Deliverance. What could possibly go right? Well, it's fall, and you know what that means. It's time for aging cinema icons to reclaim their youth on screen. Yeah. Let's see what Diane Keaton, Morgan Freeman, Kevin Kline, Susan Sarandon, Robert De Niro, and probably Katherine Heigl are up to. Oh, wait, what's that? Oh, they're due to relive their youth and make up for lost time in October.
Oh.
Okay, well, let's check in with Robert Redford and Nick Nolte.
A Walk in the Clouds.
That's A Walk in the Woods.
A Walk in the Woods brings together the comic duo of Redford and Nolte to tell the tale of two men in their 40s, at least the book did, who decide they don't want to live, they don't want their life to be about dying, but about living.
It turns out that hiking the Appalachian Trail isn't as easy as it was when they were young, back when it was still pretty damn impossible. Yeah. So they give up the end. No, that's not how it ends. They come together, put aside their differences, and realize the real reason they're hiking the trail. It's not about where they're going. It's about, I don't know, something else. Ask your aunt.
A Walk to Remember.
A Walk in the Woods.
A Walk in the Woods release date is 2 months away from being nominated for an Oscar, and it's a movie that appears to be two deaths away from winning an Independent Spirit Award.
In order to keep his old lady off his back, Bill Bryson has to find someone willing to join him on the Appalachian Trail hike. Unfortunately, none of his friends are too keen on the idea.
How would you like to join me for a little stroll?
Not in this lifetime.
Next time, call me for something fun, like a colonoscopy.
That is until a long-lost friend surfaces, all too willing to set out on this wild adventure that is sure to kill them both. And so off they go, and the pair of septuagenarians encounter all the trials and tribulations you would expect. Inclement weather, twisted ankles, falling into a river, forgetting where they are, lost backpacks, forgetting where they are, bear attacks, forgetting where they are.
The movie features Nick Nolte, who, though not entirely coherent, at least seems to realize that he's in a movie and that people are filming him.
Yeah, this seems right, but I'm all these years, that can't be good for you.
We all know Nolte is a pretty method actor, and rumor has it he got diabetes for this role.
And Emma Thompson stars as age-appropriate wife-ish.
Things get a little complicated, at least we hope, when it's discovered that Nick Nolte's character, Stephen Katz, is on the lam and ducking out on some debts. And apparently learning of this reality forces the pair of intrepid hikers to fall comically into the river and get all wet. Oh, hilarity. Will you ever cease to ensue?
At least we think that's the cause and effect here. Otherwise, you would have a scene of two old guys falling into a river for no reason. And that wouldn't make any sense at all. Actually, it's quite sad when you think about it.
If you didn't know the movie was about exuberant freedom, the trailer has every song that has ever contained that emotion, from Walk of Life to that one Paul Simon song to, I think, three fake Mumford & Sons songs.
Will they find what they're looking for? Will they rekindle their friendship? Will they remember where they are and why they're carrying backpacks?
All right, sincere question here. Does Robert Redford have to let this film into Sundance? Do you have an in over there?
Good question. Do you have an in?
Steve Schultz, the writing contributor to the show,
Stevie,
says he would be in on this in a second if it had Steve Martin and John Candy.
Oh.
But you just can't do it. Oh,
wow. That would be The Great Outdoors with the great John Candy and the great Dan Aykroyd.
Yeah, we
that
should.
That was a thing. Yeah, mm-hmm. You're right.
Should recast movies with John Candy. What
just
are we missing?
All of them, like, yeah. Right? Yeah. No problem.
Who would he play in?
But, that being said,
I'm amazed.
I'd see this.
Would you?
Oh, I'm going to see this. Would. Yeah, why not? I think the cast
charming.
Is strong.
Yeah,
the trailer
goof,
was good.
But I'm going.
I know, right.
I know.
Movie pass.
I saw a play on Broadway in the 80s called A Walk in the Woods. It was about a Russian diplomat and American
an American diplomat. Yeah,
diplomat,
I think
and
that's
it was
Into the Woods, right?
No, that's about Little Red Riding Hood.
Oh,
no, A Walk in the Woods is fantastic. It's a really great play. I watched it. Matter of fact, I met some of the actors when they came to a town near my house, like this little artsy town. And the one thing I learned from that show is I was walking to the theater or something, and a man with a thick Russian accent, he stopped me, and I can't do the accent, but he was like, your shoe is untied. And I was like, oh, gosh, how crazy. And he goes, let me teach you the Russian way to tie shoe. I'm like, oh, all right. It is the greatest way to tie your shoe ever, and your shoe does not come untied.
What? Yeah. There's a Russian way to tie your shoe?
Yeah, and it's not like over the, you know, the rabbit and all that crap. It's really easy, and it works perfectly, and your shoe is never, you don't have to double knot it.
Does it involve drab state-funded housing?
It involves waiting in long lines to tie your shoe.
One of my favorite things is when Paul says anything as a Russian villain in an 80s action movie, can you say, I would like to tie your shoe as a Russian villain?
I would like to tie your shoes in Russian way.
And to this day, that's how I tie my shoe. I'll show you guys later. It's fantastic.
Here's why I'll see this movie, because I was watching the trailer and was reminded of just how much fun it is to watch Robert Redford.
Yeah, yeah.
I love him. And, you know, we're 20 years removed from Quiz Show, the last great thing he did. Oh, that movie is
interesting. Well, Sneakers.
So great.
Sneakers.
That was before Quiz Show.
Was it before?
Yeah. Do you think he will stop to shave Paul Preston?
Oh, God. Here we go.
Well, you won't stop giving that movie shit, will you? Jesus. And it's a movie with one guy in it for the whole movie. It's like, all right, it's got to be a bit of a crutch. Like, if it goes astray for the one scene where he shaves, what is that called?
Have you not heard Karen's movie review?
Guy in the Boat.
I know this.
Spider-Man is shit because Kirsten Dunst wears high heels when she's waiting tables.
Way caught up.
Shit movie.
Way caught up.
No, I do want to do a retraction on Karen's reviews because I said Ricky and the Flash did not commit enough because Meryl Streep did not have her hair cut, but it was just braided. Having seen the movie, I will tell you that that's exactly the right choice because she's not really a successful enough musician to cut her hair off because she has to have a real job. Brilliant. So I take that back.
They can release the film. Have they released that film?
It's been approved.
This is where Karen's type of movie review and my type of movie review do not converge because I was still pissed that's not starring The Flash from the TV show. The Flash.
Exactly.
He would have committed to the hair, though.
Oh, that's true.
Mm-hmm. One of the best films I saw last year was Wild with Reese Witherspoon.
Yes. Okay.
From the director of Dallas Buyers Club, whose name I can't pronounce.
Sure.
But the whole film, she just wandered around wondering if she was going to be raped or killed, which I imagine women walk around all the time.
Well, she was on a trail by herself doing something that a man can do without even thinking twice about it. These two men are not going to wonder if when they go to sleep at night, they're going to wake up being raped.
Play that Deliverance music again, Paul. Yes, we do. Yes, we do.
The fact that I can pee standing up and I can go on a camping thing, and I hate that the world's so ugly, but boy, advantage me. I'm okay with it.
Now, these guys are older, frail, may not be able to fight back as well.
Yeah, maybe. That's true. Maybe they will get attacked by someone who finds them attractive.
Oh, my God. Now, but I am a hillbilly, so that's offensive.
I am from Ohio.
Yeah.
So what were you saying about the Appalachian Trail and Mark Sanford?
Yeah, I looked up a little bit of information because I remembered hearing something about this. Governor Mark Sanford of South Carolina, Republican, he said one of the excuses offered when he had left and they could not find him, he was actually overseas having sex with his girlfriend while he was married. But one of the things they said is his assistant said he was off hiking the Appalachian Trail, which became a euphemism in the English language.
And now, I had not heard that. I know the story. I mean, he's a douche. And a hypocrite. Yeah. But I hadn't heard that phrase. I like that.
Yeah.
They're going to go hike the Appalachian Trail.
I'm going to give it to her up the old Appalachian Trail.
Yeah, that sounds dirtier than just sex.
She's taking it up the old Appalachian Trail, if you know what I mean.
And now we're back on Wild.
There you go.
Okay, so that's Lee Daniels' A Walk in the Woods, because there was already a play.
Thank you.
But Nick Nolte's back. Karen said he looks like Uncle Jesse in this one.
He does.
Oh, Uncle Jesse.
Yeah.
With Nick Nolte showing up in A Walk Among the Tombstones.
Oh, that's a walk in the woods.
Walk in the woods. Yeah. Thanks, Adam. This gives us another chance to play What's Nick Nolte Saying?
Yay!
It's the What the Hell's Nick Nolte Saying?
New theme.
That was the theme?
All right.
That
new theme.
Amazing.
All right, let's see. Here's the fun part about this game. It's non-competitive.
Oh, good.
So you're
good.
Not trying to outguess your partner as to what Nick Nolte is saying. You're really just trying to figure out what the fuck he's trying to say.
That's it.
And you can work together to try and figure it out, okay? In the following scenes.
Maybe I'm going to write something down, and that'll help.
Here's that scene again in the walk from what we were just talking about.
Yeah, I think it is.
Walk in the woods.
All right, ready?
Okay, good. Yeah, this seems right, but one woman all these years? No, that can't be good for you.
Oh, my God.
All right, I've got a couple words. Seems and great.
It ends with, that can't be good for you.
That can't be good for you. I caught that. Please, again.
Yeah, this seems right, but one woman all these years?
Huh? I got it.
That can't be good for you.
I got it. That just shows you have to see the movie three times. But something, one woman all these years.
Kathy seems great.
Kathy seems great.
One woman all these years, but that can't be good
for
you.
But I have to get my hair cut. But is that what he said?
we might be off here.
Oh, shit.
Wow. That's kind of amazing.
It just makes me want to do that.
Right? Just clear your throat.
Well, here he is in Gangster Squad. Remember that came out last year?
We're losing Los Angeles to an Eastern crook.
We're losing Los Angeles.
To an Eastern crook?
Perhaps.
Oh, I have Croy, like C-R-O-I-X, like the city.
To the Easter Bunny.
Losing the Easter Bunny.
Losing Los Angeles to a guy from Azusa or something from the East, right?
You really do have to see
Los Angeles.
Oh. Las Vegas.
To an Eastern crook.
An Eastern crook. Crook.
Eastern crook. That's like the most vague description.
Well,
look, we don't want to offend any group or ethnicity or nationality.
Eastern.
Just Eastern.
Bad guy.
It could be
Pasadena.
Rancho Cucamonga.
Right, here he is in Blue Chips.
Oh, I'm ready.
Remember with Shaq O'Neal many moons ago?
You cannot win half-assed. Come and win this ball game. Let's go.
Okay, it was pretty coherent.
That one's pretty coherent.
You cannot win jackass?
This ball game.
No, you cannot win half-assed?
Oh, half-assed.
Then something-something ball game.
Ball game.
I want to hear more from A Walk in the Woods.
You cannot win half-assed. Come and win this ball game.
I think we first heard this. Karen said he throws a trash can in the middle of it, but we weren't sure. That might have just been him still talking, right? I think it was your comment on it last night.
Yeah.
Blue Chips. That's a good reference, by the way. If you just are like, yeah, kick back and watch Blue Chips.
Yeah, I'm in a Ron Shelton mood. And Blaze isn't on Netflix. I'm going to watch Blue Chips.
There's a reference.
Here he's nominated for an Oscar for this.
To prove that Lila Wingle would... This is your wise, Savannah.
Could
never trust her.
What?
What?
I don't know. He got too growly in that
Wait
one.
Wait a minute. That sounds like that movie.
Something with Lila Wingo. It's Prince of Tides. Wind.
Yeah, it's that movie. That sounds like the one with Liam Neeson in it.
It's Nick Nolte as Nell.
As Nell.
Prove that Lila Wingo.
Day in the wind.
Then he was in Parker. Remember Parker? Speaking of Jason Statham?
Don't start anything. He's got connections.
When we did 9 to 5, I learned all my lines the best I could, and it's hard. You have a lot of lines. I should just start.
How many times do I not know
what I'm supposed to say?
How many times did they have to do a second take and just delicately suggest that? Well, okay, Nick, can you bring a little more energy? When really what they were saying is we can't understand the damn thing you're saying.
Yeah, enunciate is what they wanted to say.
Yeah, it's funny. We played this game before. I watched the trailer and I was like, well, I actually kind of understand everything he's saying, but you have to see him.
Yeah. That's the trick.
As soon as you played a scene, I go, I know that from the trailer, but what the fuck is he saying?
Good thing film worked out for him because he's not a radio guy.
That's a good thing film worked out.
There was a game on the.
Think of all they've done you, to me, to humanity.
Wow, I know what he said, but it was really hard. Think of all the harm you've done to you, to me, and humanity. And
to humanity. Yeah. Humanity.
Good, nailed it, honey.
Man, that's like...
That's Hulk.
Yeah.
Wow, but it's hard. You have to really like follow the rhythm.
Oh, and hey, just for fun, here they are all at the same time.
You cannot win that battle. Come and win this ball game. Let's go!
To you! To me! To humanity!
You know, he just sounds like our dog, Paul. He sounds like Dr. Marvin being pissed.
All right, that's...
It's the Winter's House, Nick Nolte! Say it!
All right, it was with every round of What's Nick Nolte Saying, we all win.
Yay!
So
we do.
This is a good time to take a break. A few minutes for us, a few seconds for you, as we'll get our guest in here, Nic LaRue. Hang tight.
Soundtrack to Hot and Trot.
It does sound like the soundtrack to a lot of 80s or 90s comedies.
Yeah, maybe a little Midnight Run in there somewhere.
It's the great Leah Finkelstein, friend of the show, Boo Bay's sister. Been on some of our holiday episodes.
True.
From her album Feigning Composure. No, is it from there? Yeah. It is from there. She's got a new album coming out, so I forget what songs are from what. But hey, we are joined for the movie talk section of our show by the man behind filmsnobbery.com, known as a voice for indie film, and host of the Film Snobbery Live podcast for about 7 years, all of the episodes of which, even though filmsnobbery.com is no longer running, Everything can be found on there if you want to see great interviews with indie filmmakers and the like. They're all still up there. And the guy with us, Nic LaRue, everybody.
Yay, Nic LaRue.
Wow. Yay.
Little known fact, Nic is actually the man that the character Tim Robbins played in Bull Durham is based on.
Yes.
Nic LaRue.
Nic LaRue. Sometimes
you mean
brains.
Nuke you mean Lelouch?
Or maybe that.
Nic LaRue. I think
I was going to let him have it.
It does sound like you should be pitching long relief.
Now, wait, we should say for a second, though, because you were Nic Baisley.
I was Nic Baisley for 34 years.
And then
years.
He got married.
Yeah.
No, not yet. Actually, that's
to
not,
come.
It's a, yeah. Yes, it's actually a slightly less interesting story, but all it is
do
really
tell.
My parents divorced when I was 5. My mom and I had a conversation not too long ago where I said to her, why did you never go back to your maiden name? And she said, well, I thought it'd be weird for us both to grow up with different names. I said, well, I'm an adult now, so what's stopping you? She goes, yeah, that's a good point. I'm going to go do that. I'm like, I'll do it too.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
LaRue's way cooler. Cool.
Yeah, because we'll go with Nic LaRue. And also, my girlfriend, you know, her name is Angelique, and I thought Angelique LaRue sounded way cooler.
Absolutely. Perfect.
Where is she dancing? I mean, congratulations.
She's a main stage girl, I'm just going to say.
Main
you know?
Stage.
Absolutely.
Well, hey.
Angelique's main stage. Main stage Angelique.
Main stage is something.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's like it's like a name that, you know, when you are putting it on, you don't know with something. Oh, you know Joe LaRue over there from the, you know, my milkman or whatever.
It's one step up from Joey Bag of Donuts. It really is. You know?
But I bring it up so if you see Nic Baisley, Baisley, out there in the world associated with film snobbery, but same guy.
Wait,
same
guy.
Although I will say that Nic Baisley guy, he was kind of an asshole. This Nic LaRue guy, stand up guy.
Yeah, you can wipe that out too.
Absolutely.
Anything you said back then.
If only I could get rid of that credit card and student loan debt that quickly.
Yeah. Now, you started this whole thing not in L.A., because everyone in L.A. is all movies all the time. Just go to another town, try and talk movies. No one knows shit. And you'll be like, wow, I forgot where I was. You did this film snobbery nonsense from Massachusetts.
Massachusetts, yeah. Oxford, Massachusetts.
That's where you're from?
That's where I'm from. Oxford, Worcester, Central Mass.
Cool.
Yeah. Everyone, every time you go, like, Massachusetts, oh, Boston? No.
So what inspired you?
I've always been a movie guy.
Hey!
How about them apples?
Brandon.
Unintentional.
You owe us 3 cents.
Put it on my tab.
Okay.
I'm going to switch names again.
Bill Nic Baisley.
I grew up around movies. My parents had friends that owned a movie store, a video store. And when I got older, I worked at a movie theater, both an indie theater and a chain theater. I worked at a Blockbuster Video in 2 countries. And then I got into a lucrative career in network engineering and then got laid off in 2009.
Oh.
But I was just started talking about movies online because it was starting to be a thing for me, you know, a little kind of creative outlet. And my boss had seen some like interviews that I had done at film festivals and stuff, and they actually saw it, like they played it at work at the board meeting. And they're like, this is good stuff. How come you don't do this for a living? And I'm like, well, because I'm gainfully employed. And they're like, yeah, about that.
You're no good at engineering networks.
Yeah. So, yeah.
That's a good lesson, actually. Never count on the day job. I need to get a day job before I do anything else. No, you don't, because it's no more reliable than anything else.
It will throw you out.
I will say, no, they were totally cool about it. The guy said, you know, it was the recession had just hit in 2009, and the guy said, hey, look, you know, like, unfortunately, you're low man on the totem pole here. I can save a bunch of money just by, you know, laying you off. However, you are going to be on unemployment for about a year, which we're paying for. He goes, why don't you take that year and do something productive with it? Like, why don't you try following your passion to see if you could do something with it? And so for the first year, while I just, you know, I decided to follow his advice, for that first year, I decided, hey, I'm going to go ahead and I'm just going to see if there's an audience for what I'm doing. I'm going to listen. I'm going to be part of the conversation. I'm going to inject myself in and just see if there's any sort of people listening out there. And it turned out there was. And so I said, all right, now I'm going to give it another year and I'm going to build on it. And I'm going to see if I can do this for a career. And then it turned out that I could. And I was able to do it up to about year 5. And then I'd come home for my first time ever at Sundance. And I was like, I'm moving to Los Angeles. And then it all fell apart.
So that's the story for everyone. So
yeah. It kind of is.
Yeah, actually, yeah. We all made livings as actors before we moved here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It all, but it was indie film only from the beginning?
Almost entirely. When I first started, it was just I wanted to talk about movies I had gone to. And then, as a matter of fact, I remember the first podcast I had ever done was actually Vampires, Werewolves, Anyone.
Twilight?
Not Twilight.
Movie?
Not Twilight.
Smooth Kissable Teens?
Yes. No. Yes.
Vampire's Assistant?
No, it was...
Vampire in Brooklyn?
Not that long ago. American
Werewolf in London?
Once Underworld.
Oh, if you had said Lichens. Well,
Lichens, yeah. That's different. Yes, you're correct. Yeah. No, it was the first thing I did. I had a girlfriend of mine who we decided, oh, we're just going to go online. We're going to see if, you know, we're going to do like an hour. We were drunk. Anyway, which most good decisions are made that way.
Great start to podcasting right there.
Absolutely. You know, slurring. Yeah. So we started doing it, and then we decided, oh, let's do another show and another show and another show. And she lasted for what we call now called Film Snobbery Classic. She lasted for like 12 episodes, and then I brought in a guy, and then he lasted for about 20 episodes, and then I got rid of everybody. And then I decided I was going to do a live show, and instead of doing it pre-taped, we decided to go live. And a lot of that was out of laziness of I don't like to edit because I'm not an editor. I'm a cutter at best. a butcher, but definitely not an editor. And so I was like, well, I can preload everything on here. We had great sponsors too when we started Telestream, which does Wirecast, was a great sponsor of ours, Sony, all those. You guys owe me money now, or actually owe these guys money.
Right.
Yeah, we'll take it.
Yeah, they'll take it. So yeah, it enabled me to be able to kind of do everything a little bit one man bandish, and I had some guests come in to, you know, help me out, and we had a few local people be able to come into our quote unquote studio. And which was just a garage kind of situation that in my parents
don't know anything about
sounds
that.
Depressing.
Yeah.
Who would do that crap?
You need a real studio like what we're in right here. Yeah.
I know. I got how you guys got the Admiral's Lounge at such a low price. I have no idea.
That's because of the flyover zone, but that's all right.
Weird. Yeah, yeah. This place is entirely paid for in frequent flyer points, isn't
absolutely.
It?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, so I ran it out of there for several years, and I traveled. It was great. I mean, I got to travel all over the country. I got to do panels. I got to go to festivals. I got to go interview hundreds of filmmakers and make a lot of new friends and acquaintances along the way. And got myself a new co-host who, you know, used to call in. His name is Jerry. He's actually on his honeymoon right now.
Oh, congratulations,
so
Jerry.
Congratulations, Jerry.
Right.
And
is your
Jackie.
To this day?
He well, not anymore because we're not. You know,
Taking a hiatus.
Hiatus.
Was he there right up to the end, though? Because it seems like all you needed to do to find love was end the show.
Yeah.
That's really what it was. Like, I needed to
he's
get rid
married.
Of him.
You're getting married.
Yeah, no, he was a cool guy. He was a filmmaker, and so it was really cool because he would provide that kind of voice of the filmmaker, whereas I was more of the voice of the film critic. And, you know, it's always nice because you guys, you know, we tend to banter quite well and argue online, you know, and he'd be, hey, you fat guy. And I'm like, yeah, you dumb Jew. He's not Jewish. I don't even know why I said that. But he's.
Well, you know, when you argue with somebody, that's what my go-to.
See,
yeah, it really is.
Paul is an editor, so we can cut that out for you.
Yeah.
It's okay. The great part about not doing a show anymore is that no one's going to care.
No one cares.
you can tell I've let myself go, right? no, but anyway, so it's.
And
it was
got
a,
married.
And getting there. January 23rd, and then off on the honeymoon myself. And,
very cool.
And it's going to be
just yourself for the honeymoon? No,
well, yeah, it's expensive
selfish.
To bring the girl with
it
you.
It really is. And, you know, honestly, I think she's just going to ruin all the fun anyway.
Absolutely.
You know, it's really.
Sex is better with a woman.
Yes. January, where are we going for a honeymoon? Sundance. thanks, honey.
That actually came into play when we were making our guest list for the wedding because our it's January 23rd, which I think is right in the middle of Sundance. Yeah. And I'm just like, well, we're having our reception at Rally Studios. And I'm like, well, all the people that we invite that are our friends might not be in town.
Yeah.
So that could be a little awkward showing up. You know, well, at least we'll have it really easy when people go, like, if anyone, you know, sees anything against this, speak now or forever. Hold it. Like, it's just crickets anyway.
Right.
But, of course, I'm sure the priest will be like, yeah, I got problems here. Do you see this guy? Come on.
Look at this
come
guy.
On.
Look he looks like a Baisley to me.
Yeah.
It may start back up. My girlfriend, his fiance, wife, whatever we're calling her at this point. I actually told her I'm not doing fiance. I'm leapfrogging fiance right to wife. Because I don't want to have to memorize another like term to call her. I already call her.
Or
like,
at least learn how to spell it. That's a bitch right there, fiance.
You don't want to move that too early. Like you're the second date. You're like, can I just call you wife?
That might scare him off.
Let's review, Nick.
Might scare him.
You got to remember her name.
You got that.
I got that.
Okay, okay. And then fiance.
Fiance.
And then wife. And then back to her name again. This is really way too much for you.
Yeah, then ex-wife. On, and then that you mother of my child.
And her attorney's name.
Yeah.
This is Bart giving you this advice.
Yeah. Use your words.
So over the years.
I feel like there's a bit of experience talking here for you now.
Wait, so I want to jump to what, because as a guy who's been focused on indie film for about 7 years.
Yes.
I'm curious what your favorite movie of all time is.
Ah,
we asked this guest of every guest.
Favorite indie movie or regular
mainstream
movie?
Let's go for it. All right.
Or just your favorite movie. If it's an indie, it's an indie.
Bonus points if you don't say that's a tough question.
No, I'm not going to say it's a tough question. I actually do know. The indie one's a bit of a tough question. However, the regular one I've got, only problem is that because of recent events, I'm sure everyone is saying this now, and it is Nightmare on Elm Street.
Is that a first?
A Nightmare on Elm Street to me, I think, is a perfect movie.
I thought you were going to say Ghostbusters because they're remaking it. But anyway, yeah.
I do love Ghostbusters, too. I mean,
Karen, you always weasel your favorite movie of all time into the conversation.
Karen, we know what your favorite movie of all time is. The listeners know what your favorite movie of all time is. You know it. I know it. Dogs know it.
The American people know it.
But a Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yeah. That's good. You have a fantastic lead actress, you know, who's the hero of a movie. It's really well written.
Is
you
it
have
action
a great. It's mm-hmm. action. You got a great psychosexual kind of tension between her and the villain, and Robert Englund is just fantastic. You know, and I hear hopefully if they're rebooting this again, which I hear they're doing, that he may have or will be signing on.
Oh.
I've heard there's been a talk or a discussion about this, so we'll see what happens.
It really was silly to not have him in the Platinum Dunes one, because it's like, all right, I get that you want to reboot this, but if you're going to be boring because you don't have Robert Englund in your movie, then... You know, put Robert Englund in the reboot.
He's
right?
around.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, exactly.
I bet he's available.
Yeah. Well, he wasn't, you know, he wasn't playing the vegetarian alien in V again, so in that reboot, so, which I do think deserves a big budget movie.
V?
Yeah.
I loved V when I was a kid.
Yeah.
I never saw the reboot, though.
The reboot wasn't horrible. I mean, Marina Baccarin and Laura Vandervoort and, you know, some people there.
Ooh.
It wasn't, Supergirl in Smallville.
Oh, I gotcha.
Hey, did you see who just got cast in Supergirl?
No.
Glenn Morshower.
Yes.
Yay! Friend of the show.
I love Glenn. Glenn is such a great guy.
Is he the best?
Yes.
And he's going to play Lois Lane's dad.
Sam Lane.
Nice. Sam Lane.
Sam Lane. Yeah. Wow.
Sam Lane. My wedding is comic book themed. So
is it really?
I proposed to my girlfriend in a comic book store.
What?
In our comic book store, I should say.
And she's on board with all this. So
she's on board with all this, yeah. She's
She's
far more DC Comics than I am. I'm more Marvel guy.
Oh, however, Marvel and DC coming together.
Really,
yeah.
Coming
yeah.
together.
We thought that that's how we were actually going to set up the parents and stuff like that. It was going to be like her family's all DC, mine's all Marvel. But we thought that would just be too much.
Oh, I'm at the Lobo table.
You're living the dream.
Yeah, no, I was going if I was going to see you, I'd put you in... I don't know, Toy Master.
Oh,
or something like that. Yeah,
Toy Master.
Toy Master.
He's a Batman villain, right?
Batman villain.
Is there a blue devil table?
There's a blue devil table. There's a blue beetle table. No.
Toy Master is in the most recent Batman animated movie, voiced by Weird Al Yankovic. So I will take your Toy Master and sit at that table.
Fantastic.
If I was going, which I'm not.
But
you work at Raleigh Studios.
I do. I work at Raleigh Studios. Yeah, it's where we're having our wedding reception. Actually, it's a comic book thing. We're going to show the Superman, the Chris Reeve original Superman movie.
Oh, my God.
You know, to those who are interested. You know, if it's like, you don't want to dance or you don't want to do all that kind of stuff, that's fine. You go ahead and you...
You're the perfect person to ask this question to. And I have this thing. I've expressed this thing. The casting of Christopher Reeve.
Yes.
When you watch him playing that,
mm-hmm.
what is going on there? That is the most perfect, crazy... He is Superman and Clark Kent.
Absolutely.
And I don't know if there's more perfect casting that's ever been done. I don't know what it is. It's so crazy perfect.
When he was that scene in was it Superman 2 when they're doing the he's going to go tell Lois, you know, who he is, and he takes off the glasses and straightens up. Oh, it's fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, yes, that's perfect. It's kind of like how in for Christian Bale, I was like, I had to see Equilibrium to believe he could be Batman and American Psycho to believe he could be Bruce Wayne.
Oh.
That's really how I got my Christian Bale. I'm like, yes, he can do this.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. I don't know where he got that voice from, but.
Yeah. I know. It had to be different, so it was that.
It was that.
So people don't know I'm Bruce Wayne. I'm this. Yeah.
that's your move? Okay.
Yeah. But it was the same thing with Daredevil and the same thing with the original Tim Burton Batman.
Yeah,
they all
kind
of, you know, choke that up a little bit.
Yeah, otherwise it sounds just like Bruce. Hey, you sound just like Bruce Wayne.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Flash doesn't have to do that. Just saying. He'll either do that, like, weird voice
yeah,
thing, that modulation.
So you're, like, super comic book guy, but then you went into indie film for your love of for everything you want to talk about movie-wise.
These people work hard. They need recognition. That was the whole point of it. I was just like, I can go to the movies, and I can see 1,000 people talking about mainstream film. And honestly, it really was, like, there were guys out there. You look at, like, Slash Film or FirstShowing.net or some of the larger film websites out there, the movie guys.
Everybody but IO9.
Pretty much. But you look
at terrible.
Great reference.
I mean, my God. They just couldn't write the worst reviews I've seen in the last 4 months. Anyway, go ahead.
But, and I realized one thing really quickly. I would never be able to get a head start doing major reviews, like main online kind of major big box office reviews, because these guys already had the access, they already had the traction, they already had the ins, and just they were getting the exclusives. I was not going to get that. But I knew that if I was being personable one-on-one with a lot of these filmmakers, I knew that I could get that access. Independent film was still accessible when I started, and it still is, and it's just so audience driven now in terms of reviews and stuff like that it's really difficult to maintain. I find it harder to maintain an audience in terms of profit, because I work with independent filmmakers. I can't go to them for profit, because there is no profit there. So when you have to look at, like, sponsors and advertising, my background aside from tech is marketing. So everything for me from day one was, it was, let's listen to what the audience wants. Let's look for the niche that needs to be filled. And it just turned out to be independent film. And how can I monetize this as a career and still be happy and in love with what I do? And I was able to do that for about 5 of my 7 years and just pretty much live off of my passion. It became really much more complicated once I moved out here.
Yeah. Interesting. When did this all take place for you? Because Adam and I had a show back in '99 called Director's Cut that serviced the same community. And I went to Sundance, and I found that the independent film community loved me until they got to Sundance. I could get them on my show. I was handing out $20 bills for all practical purposes. But once they got to Sundance, they're like, oh, no, I'm at Sundance now. I don't need you to help market my movie.
Yeah,
they weren't the most gracious group, I've noticed.
Well, I mean, once you go to Sundance, looking at Sundance as an independent film festival, especially nowadays, is kind of like looking at Tribeca as an independent film festival.
This was 97, 98.
Yeah, this was a little bit better. I mean, like, this was Kevin Smith chasing Amy style or Dogma or whatever. I mean, where he was still able to throw some, you know, throw a movie in there and it was still considered, you know, kind of indie-ish.
Yeah.
I went in 2011. I actually, I want to give a shout out to, again, another site now defunct, Film Threat. I went with Mark Bell from Film Threat, and those guys just said, hey, you know, we're going to do a co-production, we'll put you up and, you know, fly you out and all that kind of stuff, and you'll just be in charge of all the video stuff because that's kind of your thing. I did video interviews. And so I went and just trugged a 50-pound pack up and down Main Street for 7 days or however long we were there for. And just, you know, at the absolute mercy of PR people, which, you know, by and large, always got along with well. However, some of them could be just very disorganized.
It's kind of a rite of passage slogging up and down
really
the hills
is.
Of
it
Sundance
was,
with
snowing
press kits
and
shit.
Yeah,
exactly, right?
Well, snow I was fine with. I mean, Massachusetts guy, I'm fine with snow.
True.
Snow I can deal with. the thin air, fat Nick, not so much. That was always kind of the hard part. I was just like, okay, I've walked 5 feet and I want to collapse now. somebody carry me. And they're like, no, you're too big.
No.
Yeah.
And Chris Gore made a noble effort to bring back Film Threat in the last year, and it failed.
And you know what? He did well. I mean, he raised $63,000. As a matter of fact, it was funny. Right before I went on the show tonight. I actually
That's
was.
That's right.
I
he
went.
Did have a new car. You're right. Oh no, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I went on. I was like, is Film Threat even still around? So I went to Film Threat, and it actually defaults to their Kickstarter. You know, failed, if you want to call it that, yeah. unsuccessful Kickstarter.
Gosh,
yeah. Failed is such a harsh.
It really
word.
Is.
It yeah, was a finality to it.
Was that initially Film Threat was initially a zine, right? Or sorry,
it was a magazine. I mean,
so the digital age, like it's like yeah, you gotta kind of do a free Twitter account and do it for free.
Yeah, they actually, I mean, they pioneered not well. I'm gonna go as far as to say pioneered a lot. They had a magazine and then they had a distribution arm as well. I mean, they were doing video distribution at one point. Then they wow. you know then they had the online presence and then everything else kind of slowly went away because print was phasing out. And then, you know, I'm assuming the distribution just didn't be, it probably was not as profitable as they would have liked, or it was outsourced somewhere. I don't know the behind the scenes details. And then Chris decided to detach from that and, you know, promote up Mark, and Mark took over and then, you know, eventually, you know, bought it basically. And then, you know, once they just couldn't get it, you know, going to where they needed to be. It went back to Chris, and you know, Chris just couldn't get it running back again. But again, valiant effort. I mean, and Chris had a lot of other things that he was, you know, working on. So, you know, again, like you said, valiant effort. And it sucks because it's not the only site. I mean, Gordon and the Whale went away. Cinematical.
The Dissolve now is gone.
The Dissolve is gone. Yeah. Cinematical got bought by AOL, and then they got dissolved. No pun intended. And then Film Threat, and then I mean, like it's just we're all falling like dominoes at this point. And really, what it comes down to is sustainability.
Yeah.
And
that was the Dissolves thing. They had, a financial and power structure didn't work.
Yeah.
Well, the only ones who are really huge now still are, I mean, you have Slash Film, obviously, but IndieWire. And IndieWire is funded by, was it Amazon or who are they?
They're owned, like that. Yeah.
They're owned by a larger, you know, entity. So, you know, their bottom line is probably a little less than, you know, what, you know, everyone else's is. They're
so you think maybe get involved with one of them, or do you want to relaunch? You really want to relaunch?
It's, I would hate really to just let, you know, all that work, and not only my work, the work of, I mean, I was managing upwards of 20 writers at one point worldwide, and everyone worked really hard. There was a lot of passion behind it. Even when I announced that I was thinking of stopping it, I mean, there were people that were stepping up and saying, what if I just took it over for you temporarily, and then until you kind of get your stuff straightened out, then you can come back in and maybe, you know, we'll see what's up. And I was tempted to do it, but it really what it came down to was our audience deserves a certain level of quality, number one.
Hold on a second there, Professor.
Paul, that woke Bart up.
We might want to have a meeting here.
Quality.
And then the
audience
was,
deserves anything. What?
Sorry, this is indie film.
This is indie film.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, all right.
Yeah. I've always said that
studios have a different take.
Gotcha.
If you spend $5,000 on a movie and the movie sucks, maybe we can have a conversation. You spend $250 million on it, then I'm thinking there's no excuse.
There's blame to be
we
had.
Do not
who's to blame?
We do not post reviews of indie films on themovieguys.net that we don't like.
Really?
Yep. We'll go either way for a major studio release, but we'll only post positive reviews of indie films because, why kick a film that might be having trouble enough getting made as it is, and then you go and crap on it?
Well, I said this last week or a week before. No one tries to make a bad movie, right? So you can't hate the movie, and that's why bad or critical reviews of small movies is just pointless. Now, again, if you have $250 million, then you just didn't try, or you're lazy, or you're being a dick about something. But
yeah, someone dropped the ball.
Yeah, there's blame to be had there, but when you're raising, you know, the $63,000 that Chris Gore did on his car, then, you know.
He calls it the Batmobile.
The Batmobile.
Now he'll never come on the show.
No, believe me, he will.
No.
I know Chris.
Chris.
You know what? No, it's our motto, and every time I talk to a new writer about what, you know, what my expectations were of their reviews, I always said, no, it's education before evisceration. Mm-hmm. The idea is like, it's fine if it's not good, but let's explain to them how they could have done it better. Because most of the people that we reviewed their movies, they were first-time filmmakers, and they were, you know, most of them were inexperienced. And my goal was always to try to some degree to help a first-time filmmaker get to the point where they can make a second film. Everything on our website was always, it was never necessarily designed to be entertaining. It was meant to design to be put in a portfolio at one point for, you know, not necessarily going, oh, this is your pull quote. But, I mean, at the same time, you know, printed out the page and you could put it into something and figure out how you'd like to use it in your marketing.
Made this, and here's some validation for its quality and the hard work I put into it.
Absolutely.
Now, how did you grow? I mean, we know, but how did you grow to a staff of like 20? from this idea you had to sort of grow a business and end up at film festivals and stuff like that. You know,
honestly, a lot of very passionate people. Yeah. And a lot of people who were willing to work for free that didn't deserve to, in terms of I felt they deserved more, which was another reason why
Karen points to herself.
I was just pointing at myself and Bart. Bart.
Checks are in the mail, guys. Checks are in the mail.
I'm just saying, I'm behind Nick.
Well, that was another reason why. That was another reason why for the shutdown. It was you know, not only could I not sustain myself, but I felt there was a twinge of guilt of any profit that was coming in, whether it's from advertising or festival work or consulting, because I do consulting as well, that it wasn't being trickled down, that it was like, I have to pay rent. Holy shit. I got to a point where I didn't have a car in LA, which we all know is not fun.
Everyone looks at me. Yes, for 2 years I've not had a car.
That's how long I didn't have a car.
There's
for.
One way to get to Cahuenga and there's a wreck on it.
Jeez.
One way to get to Culver City and there's a wreck on Cahuenga. Yes.
And I work in Culver City as well, so I know that. My commute used to be 2 hours each way to get to work, and it's not fun.
I want to get to a couple more things.
Sorry.
About indie film in general.
Yeah.
What do you think is the greatest indie film movement
including horror. The US. You have to include Nightmare on Elm Street, and you have to include all the 70s horror, too. That's a big indie movie.
Yeah, is it the 70s horror? Is it the Soderbergh, Tarantino? Is it the Corman? What do you think?
I mean, you have the Sundance Kids, obviously, who are the Mavericks, as it were, and then you have guys like the film school nerds, like George Lucas and stuff like that, who came up, THX and all that kind of stuff. 70s giallo movement in Italy, and then that being made over to here. I'm actually going to go more with the early stuff, way back in like the 1920s.
The original.
I'm going back.
Indie movement.
Yeah, I mean,
can you remind us of what your Paul website Robeson was called?
Film snobbery.
Okay. Well played, sir. Well played. I'm going to go back to the 20s.
I'm going to go back to the 20s.
Can you say that as though you have an ascot or perhaps a sweater tied around your neck?
Yes.
Yes, sir. I can absolutely just go ahead and describe to you right now how it was back in the 1920s.
Yes.
It was a fantastic time where we all used to go.
You're saying who
any
the
movies,
films of
independent
who?
Movies in the 20s?
I think they called them all independent movies in the 20s for the most part. No, back when lots were literally called lots because that's what they were. it was a lot of land. And
a stage was literally a piece outside, and they would put a stage down so that they could put stuff on top of
so
it,
who was,
but then out it being in the dirt.
Who was operating outside the studio system back then?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
There were some.
There was a couple people. There were filmmakers. As a matter of fact, there was a big Jewish filmmaker movement. A lot of the African American filmmaker movements, stuff like that. That they used to literally schlep their films from from theater to theater to theater, and that was before the studios tried to take control of the movie theaters, and then that got banned. And then Ronald Reagan, back in the 80s, decided, hey, guess what? Studios can own theaters again. Which is why everything you see now is a tentpole movie, and why independent films, by and large, have to black box their theaters in order to kind of get in there. And
Reagan, Michael. So walk us through some of the indie movements. Now, I'm curious. There were some old ones, and it's an interesting history, right? This sort of.
Yeah, there's some great literature out there that's available. One of my writers actually wrote a book called The History of Independent Film, and it's available out. I think it's Bear Manor Media. I don't know how I remember that, but it's written by a gentleman by the name of Phil Hall, and really well written. And it talks a lot about that Jewish movement, the African American movement, and stuff.
Then blacks could not get in regular theaters; they had to make independent films.
Yeah. And then you look at was it Remy Riefenstahl? Yes, in the movements out there in terms of propaganda film, and then you get into the 70s and a lot of the kind of stuff with that Dennis Hopper and Peter Fonda, that kind of stuff.
Well, that came out of like the AIP, the Roger Corman, and I mean, Roger Corman there is an independent filmmaker.
I love Roger Corman.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And I mean, then you get looking at Troma. You know, horror. I mean, yeah. I love, anytime I get to talk to Uncle Lloyd is always a fun time. And, you know, and thankfully he mostly remembers who I am. And his wife, Pat, is actually a darling. I like Pat. I met her at Sundance.
We interviewed Lloyd at Comic-Con, and to quote him, he said, "Oh, movie guys are my favorite movie." So I don't think, he might know who we are or what's going on. But
he called my cameraman the best damn gay cameraman he's ever done. My friend's just like, "Why is he calling me gay?" And I'm like, "Have you seen that haircut?"
To our credit, though, he was wearing pants when he said that.
Yeah, that's true. So, usually you get him in a show or something, he doesn't have his pants on. Yeah. So.
Oh, we got him just off a plane, like, from Indiana, and he was just like, I'm like, "Hey, can I do a quick sound test with you?" He's like, "Yeah. Welcome to Tromaville." He sounded like Nick Nolte. He was like, it was absolutely intelligible. I'm sitting there.
"Right now, they think they'd send me howling into the corner like a
Dad?
That was Lloyd.
Dad?
Wait, so let me ask you, what is your favorite indie film? Then of all time, is it Nightmare on Elm Street? Could be considered one, but give me another.
Could be. I mean, it was the start of New Line Cinema.
Well, that's true. Yeah. It really did start New Line, didn't it?
Yeah, it jumped.
Or screw it, then that's it.
Yeah, I mean, okay.
But I want to go around the table now. So
yeah,
what else?
Let's do that.
Your favorite indie film of all time? I got one.
Hmm. Talk to me, Goose.
Well, I would say Pulp Fiction, but it might have been a little too. I mean. What was that, his second film?
Yeah, Reservoir Dogs.
So Reservoir feels more indie. Pulp Fiction, you know, had a Travolta in it, and it seemed like, you know, it was a little Brad Bruce Willis in it. But yeah, but I'm going to go with Do the Right Thing.
Nice, Spike Lee.
And I know that's still a couple films into his career, too, but I just, man, that movie, it's a product of timing as well. You know, but when I saw that movie, I was just the right age where we quoted it ad nauseum, and I was just impressed as a young filmmaker who loved Spielberg and all that kind of stuff to suddenly see, what are these angles? What the hell is that score all about? Mm-hmm. And of course, a whole new message that I just was brand new to me. So,
and it's a firebrand of a movie. It's there to be in your face. That was the thing about Do the Right Thing. Is like, holy shit, this movie is in my face. Like, it's not afraid to get up in your grill.
It's characters talk right to the camera.
Right? Yeah, you know? Absolutely.
What was the one with Mickey and Mallory Knox?
Natural Born Killer.
Was that indie? No.
That was a Warner Brothers.
Probably not.
Okay, I like the way it looked. Never mind.
It had that feel, though.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, see, that's the thing.
Stone made that, breaking away from the way he made, you know, Platoon and Wall Street.
I mean, you know what? I would go ahead and accept that, because what I think is so interesting is, as we've been talking about this, and I knew you were coming on about the indie film thing, I have thought, yes, there's a lot of indie film movements. It's an interesting story history. I do like the horror phase of indie film in the 70s, and just how profitable that was. I love the indie film of the 80s and when VHS was invented, and how sort of profitable those little guys were, because the big studios wouldn't sell the rights to video stores. So all these indie people were like, I can sell these tapes for $100 a piece, and you're sitting on your properties? Like, fine, I'll just make all the money here. But the first one that really got labeled, and the first time we started using the term indie film, is that Robert Rodriguez, you know, El Mariachi and Reservoir Dogs and Pulp Fiction and Clerks era.
Sex, Lies, and Videotape.
Sex, Lies, and Videotape. Yeah. And so the fact that because it was labeled indie film, it inspired so many people to make movies, unlike Roger Corman, who was arguably a more profitable independent filmmaker than anybody we've mentioned. But he didn't necessarily, with the exception of a few people, did not inspire a generation the way the indie film of the 90s did. So I'm going to go Clerks.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
You know?
Nice. Nice.
Bart? Yep. I was going to say Clerks as well. Yeah. I don't know if it's my favorite. I think there are other better movies out there, but I remember in a theater watching Clerks thinking, holy shit, they actually put an independent film in a theater.
Because before the black and white thing?
Yeah, you had seen independent films, and they didn't look like independent films. They looked like movie studio productions, and they were independent. Pulp Fiction, for example, by definition, like strict definition, but this looked like the thing I had made, right? This looked like movies I had made in college, here it is in a real theater. So that was the most impressionable independent film for me.
And we got we're running short on time, but I want to ask you then, let me rephrase this question for you, Nick. What is the best movie you saw because of filmsnobbery.com?
Oh, wow. I'm going to say it might not be the best, but it was the most influential to me because it got me my co-host. Hmm. And that was Jerry Cavallaro's Stuck Like Chuck, which we promoted ad nauseum for like 2-3 years. Like it was always, this conversation would always go back to Stuck Like Chalk. But I mean, there's guys like Zach Forsman making movies like Down and Dangerous, and Paul Osborne. I love
Official Rejection.
Official Rejection. Yeah, great movie. And then Favor's great too.
Yeah, I saw your review of that. Yeah, it was good.
Yeah, it was favorable.
Indeed.
Yes. How about them apples?
Yeah, no, there were some crossovers. We have had, Alex Albrecht on the show.
I love Alex.
Yeah, and and Paul. And,
Yep.
So, but what is it? Stuck Like Chuck?
Stuck Like Chuck. Okay. Yeah, it was made for $5,000. Wow. It has Lloyd in it, Lloyd Kaufman, but also has Chris Elliott in it.
Oh,
yeah. Cool.
He is a guy who made it for $5,000. He was 19 years old, paid all his people, paid for his music, had a great soundtrack, you know, of like a bunch of like pop indie, pop rock indie bands. And made a movie with what he had. He filmed it at his school and in his grandmother's house, where like he made up a room in his grandmother's house to look like a dorm room. Went and casted actors, you know, that were arguably pretty good. And I still give him shit to this day about his lighting. His dialogue is great, and I've read several scripts of his since then, and his dialogue is still his strongest feature.
Lighting and sound, man. They can just, like, kill a script if you're not careful.
No, absolutely.
Probably sound more than lighting in some ways, because if you light it a certain way or whatever, it's like, oh, that's a visual style. But if the sound is bad, it's like, that's a terrible movie.
Yes. Yeah. You know, it was funny. I got tagged in a good way for reviewing a movie called Chiaroscuro Baby. It's all in black and white, but it's all... the sound is done in a very scratchy, almost a vinyl kind of way.
Okay.
And everyone else who had reviewed this film said to him, it's a good movie, but your sound is shit. And I'm like, no, this is a style choice. Stylized, and he's like, you're the only one who noticed. Either that or he's just being like, this is how I cover up that my sound was shit.
All right, well, let's get on to, we're going to have to burn through this. Sorry, we always crimp this poor segment, but we're running out of time. But let's talk about...
What did you see this week?
Yeah, we don't have time for that. So, Nick, you saw one of the movies we talked about at the top of the show.
Yeah.
In the Woods?
Into the Woods? Oh.
Sure.
You're out of the woods.
Take a hike?
Go walks a home alone at night? No.
Liked it, right?
Is it It Follows?
Yeah, I did. I actually did like it. I liked it way better than All Is Lost, or as my girlfriend calls it, the silly boat movie.
Thank you. Like your girlfriend. She's smart.
Yeah. Well, we screened that for the, what do you call it there? The for your consideration stuff literally 6 months at said theater trying to get critics and stuff on board for that, because we're like, okay, they're either going for the SAG award or they're going for the Indie Spirit or it was tough. Liked it better than that. Nick Nolte steals the show. I mean, I Nick Nolte out Redford's Redford.
I had a feeling from the trailer. I thought, wow, I think Nick Nolte not only knows he's in a movie, but I think he actually wants to be good. I think we might get a little old Nick Nolte back.
Redford, to me, underplays everything. So is Nolte doing that, or is he... Because he's looking rather... He's got the bravado kicking in this one.
Yeah, they made him look like Streetwalker Nolte, like like Mugshot Nolte.
Yeah.
But he is playing at a level that I like to call 48 hours Nolte.
Oh!
It's a good Nolte.
Yes!
It's a good Nolte.
That's
good
Nolte. That's good.
You've crystallized what's good.
Karen and I saw Ricky in the Flash.
Yes, we did.
The fight crime?
No, I wish they did. Rick Springfield was a surprisingly strong part of that movie. I didn't know why, but it just didn't do anything for me, which is a bummer because I always like Meryl Streep. She was fine, but I just didn't buy her in that part. But what was really weird was I don't know if the story compelled me. Nothing really happened.
Didn't for me. Yeah.
So she has to reconnect with her daughter, right?
Yeah, but
she's on the road.
Didn't do it. No, not really.
Okay. She goes back to do that,
and then sort of that gets worked out, and then she goes back to where she was, and
okay. And there's a wedding,
and then she goes back for that.
There's like no tension, you're saying?
No.
Like, is she gonna succeed? Oh, she's already succeeding before I could finish the sentence.
Yeah.
The only time I choked up, and this has nothing to do with the movie, but it has everything to do with my upbringing, I choked up whenever Rick Springfield's character does something. I don't know. I don't want to ruin it. I mean, it's the only compelling part of the movie. He does something that my family was told never do
oh, right, right.
to make her
act in a movie with Meryl Streep.
Yes, my family said just don't act with Meryl Streep. No, he does something very thoughtful to give her enough money to go home to her daughter or son's wedding, and I was like, oh my God! But not because of the movie, but because my family all. What it is my family all plays instruments. We all play musical instruments, and we've never had a lot of money, but we would get like our tax refund check. We'd all get new glasses
and go get ukuleles,
and then we'd all go get new musical equipment, and we would get guitars and amps and whatever it was. Because then we invested that money and we made money on the weekends. But he sells his guitar. We were told never sell your instruments,
no matter how bad it gets.
No matter how bad, because you can make money with your instruments, and he sells his, and I'm like. That was the most exciting part.
Then we saw Ant-Man, finally.
Ant-Man.
I liked it a lot.
Does he battle Uncle Woman?
No.
DC's Uncle Woman?
Here's what I liked about it, Adam. I liked the fact that there's a story and I can follow the characters.
Right.
And I like that I can see the action. It's very thoughtful, very well directed, and it's well conceptualized, and it's well executed. I like when I can see my superhero punching somebody in the face with whatever clever way he's doing it.
It is really well conceptualized and executed. Now, I don't know if this happens in the comic, probably, but I figured he shrinks himself to an ant and he has adventures. No, he's popping between
life-size
and ants as necessary to get where he needs to go.
Like, he can run at the door, get small, go through the keyhole, then get big again and beat your ass.
And to be honest with you, a lot of stuff happened in that movie, and I was like, okay, this is interesting. I wasn't, like, overwhelmed until he fights a guest who shows up halfway through the movie.
They posted it online. You can say
he's an Avenger. Yeah,
you can say it online.
That was cool.
And they fight. And then, of course, the last 20 minutes that are all fights and battles. I mean, that stuff is the best part of the movie.
It's very interesting.
And so you go out on a high. It's quite
unlike
good.
Moulin Rouge, that movie a billion years ago. In that, there's all these wonderful dancers doing these dances, and you can't see any of it. Because as soon as the dancers start dancing, the camera goes all over the place, and it made me so aggravated because I'm like, could you just hold still a second? There's talented people dancing. But this actually held still so I could see the man of ant.
He shot the action scenes very cleverly. So yeah,
I did like the Edgar Wright elements clearly left in that movie, which is where Michael Pena tells the story. He's a guy who used to knock over things with Paul Rudd, and Paul Rudd gets out, and he's trying to tell him about a new job, and he's like, so
he's
is
funny.
It this art opening, man? And I was looking at this and then it zooms
that
right to it.
Fantastic.
It does the whole Edgar Wright thing.
That actor is so great.
Yeah, he's great.
So that's a good one. I look forward to more Ant-Man and future Avengers movies.
I saw Roadhouse and I really liked it.
Oh, yeah.
I really enjoyed Roadhouse.
Classic.
Yeah. Classic.
Yeah, it was the first time I ever saw that.
Lots of sex and boobies and lots of nakedness in that movie.
That's a 70s movie.
You used
Very
to be able to have that in the
interesting.
Movie.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Lots of women just having their boobs out for no reason.
Yep.
You don't get
There's
that.
Always a reason for boobs.
It's a 70s movie in 1989.
Oh, my God. And the men were such scumbags. They were all like Mr. Hart.
They're all people who would never. I don't understand how they could ever get along the rest of their day because they're so ridiculously awful
Gross.
And filthy people. In the time we meet them at the bar, and they're at a bar that no one would ever go to ever because they're so ridiculously
it's so
filthy
gross.
And nasty.
I always thought that that bar was it was the offshoot. Like there was a sequel movie to that, and it was called The Accused. That was. Yes, I think that it takes place at that bar.
Yeah, it's the worst
Good
place
reference.
In the world.
And what woman would ever go to that bar knowing it's like that? And they go with their friends to go get raped? That's all it is.
Who's the girl in Roadhouse?
Let's go get raped.
It's Tuesday.
Kelly Lynch.
Kelly Lynch. The Kelly McGillis of Roadhouse movies.
Anybody else got a quick thing they saw? Where time is it ticking? No, we're on to the final part of our show.
Something
the new
Bell.
We're running. Let's take things home the way we know how best. And it's our weekly celebration of the birthdays of those who make the movies. It's Karen's birthdays.
Yeah. All right, let's start off our week of birthdays by wishing a very happy birthday to director Mark Preston Webb. Paul, he is the same age as you do. He's Paul's brother. Oh. He turns 41, but he can play anywhere from a director of music videos to a director of arachnids. Kind of funny that the man that Columbia Pictures chose to direct the Amazing Spider-Man movies would have the last name Webb.
Da, da.
Weird. Mm-hmm. I also find it kind of funny that Mark's first feature-length film was a romantic comedy, 500 Days of Summer, starring Joseph Gordon-Levitt and Zooey Deschanel. Paul and I saw that. Very charming little
That's
movie.
Good film.
So, of course, it would make sense. The next logical step was to have him direct a superhero movie.
Indie film, 500 Days of Summer?
studio indie.
Studio indie. All right.
That's a thing.
That's actually how I introduced my girlfriend to independent films. She's not an indie.
You gotta ease her in.
Yeah, you gotta. Like a warm bath.
Ease it in.
Then you can go. Yeah, here's Elephant Man.
Yeah.
Now, Mark directed The Amazing Spider-Man, a reboot of the Spider-Man film franchise, which starred Andrew Garfield and Emma Stone. Then he returned to direct the sequel, The Amazing Spider-Man 2, and currently he is directing the television version of Limitless, which he also directed the movie version with Bradley Cooper, if you guys remember.
After that film? Oh, I wasn't aware.
Yeah, but now they're doing the TV version.
Yeah,
so there you go. After that, he is in pre-production right now on a movie called Gifted, and IMDb sums up the plot as a man who tries to raise the brilliant young daughter of his dead sister, but battles with the child's mother over custody. So it's good to see that he's going back to his romantic comedy roots. So next up, let's wish a very happy birthday to Miss Lily Tomlin. She turned 76, but can play anywhere from a spoiled little girl, Edith Ann.
76 ringy dingies.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
My name is Edith Ann, and that's the truth.
Never got that bit.
Nope. All the way from that to a spoiled little adult.
Leave me the fuck alone.
Okay, there we go.
You know what the fuck is going on, period. Fuck you.
Miss Tomlin is currently starring as Frankie in the Netflix original series known as Grace and Frankie, which reunites Lily Tomlin with her 9-to-5 co-star and her best friend, Jane Fonda. We all know Lily Tomlin from her one-woman shows, her work on Laugh, and of course her movie, 9-to-5. And my favorite, All of Me. You guys, can you get on board with that?
All of me.
I would put that her high point in my book.
She's fantastic in that. I mean, with Steve Martin, the physical comedy alone.
Wasn't she in Nashville? Like,
yes, she played a country
Someone would
and
probably
Western
say
singer.
That's. Yeah. I'm sorry if you said that.
I think she won an Academy Award or was nominated for that.
Yeah, but I would go with All of Me.
Yeah.
But what roles did Miss Tomlin turn down? How would movies have been different had she accepted? Well, let's look at One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. She turned down the role of Nurse Ratched.
Oh, I could see that.
Really?
Absolutely.
Right? Yes. Absolutely.
Play that clip again. Yeah, that's her.
Leave me the fuck alone. Of course, we all know that went to Louise Fletcher. Of course, Poltergeist. She turned down the role of the mother in that. I don't know if she's sweet enough, right?
No. You can't play opposite coach.
I just found that one interesting. Oh, this one I totally did not get. She was in consideration. Now, she didn't turn it down. She was just interested in playing the lead in the best little whorehouse in Texas.
Dolly Parton's role?
Yeah. Dolly Parton nails that role. The whole point.
Never seen it.
Fun. Yeah,
Burt Reynolds is heyday. I'll see you then.
Burt Reynolds' heyday. Dolly's adorable, and there's a lot of women running around.
She nails that part twice. You know what I mean?
What? A lot of cute women running around being whores, so you'd like it.
Yeah, and her jugs are hanging out the whole time.
Totally.
It's great.
And not for nothing, I still love when the Universal Tour goes by the house that's used as the chicken ranch in that movie, and they say, there's the set we used for Best Little Whorehouse in Texas. I just look around like, are we really just shout, there's the whorehouse, kids? I just love it.
In my tour, we only get to that if I haven't first told everyone about the house from the Mindy Project that's used for Danny Castellaneta's mother, Rhea Perlman's character. If we don't have enough time, well, we don't talk about the house.
Time.
There's important things going on.
You got to jam-pack that with the Mindy Project.
Your Mindy Project stuff. All right, then also, Popeye, she was originally going to play Shelley Duvall's part in that opposite Dustin Hoffman.
As Popeye?
Yes, that all changed up, right? Because then Robin Williams did it with Shelley Duvall.
I find it difficult to believe because Altman had Shelley Duvall in a lot of his movies. So I thought, that's a natural choice. Not only is it for an Altman movie, but of course she looks just like olive oil. That's an amazing casting.
Perfect.
Yeah.
All right, and then of course Bart. You know how much I love it when celebrities sing.
This is true. People are always asking me, Nick. Can you tell me two interesting things about Karen? And I say absolutely.
What?
When she wants to go out and not be recognized, she'll wear a blonde wig, but not on her head.
That's right. I merkin it.
She merkins it. And then the other thing, she loves when celebrities sing.
I do. And you know what? I especially love when one of our favorite movie guy celebrities sings. Now, it's his birthday. But
Nick
we
Nolte?
Already we learned so much about Keanu Cool Breeze Reeves last time that I didn't want to bring him back and do all that again. But I did want to give him a little singing. So here he is. He is Nelson Moss in this. Demonstrating his vocal skills in the film Sweet November, singing time after time, made famous by Mr. Frank Sinatra.
That's him and
Little Cool Breeze
Charlize
Reeves.
Charlize
Theron? Yes.
Time after time? That's not
all right, and then we got one.
Yeah, not the Cyndi Lauper.
Okay. Now we're going to play this, and it's got a minute. So then I got a minute to sign off the show. Here
all right,
we go.
All right, we'll be quiet.
And go.
only know.
This is Keanu.
What I
yes.
Know. Cool Breeze.
Cool Breeze singing, everybody. The passing
years. That wraps another movie showcast, everybody. Together we're the movie guys. Individually we are.
Careful,
guys.
Follow us on Twitter at The Movie Guys. We're also on Facebook, iTunes, Vimeo, YouTube, SoundCloud, Vine, Instagram, all that
no
shit.
Way.
Thanks to Nic LaRue.
Yay!
Thank you very much.
And that's a tip from LaRue to you.
Oh.
Is it Nick at Nick Baisley, though? Is still your Twitter handle?
No, it's at Film Snobbery. Everything
film
is
snobbery.
Everything is Film Snobbery.
There yes, you go. It is.
It'll be back.
Yes, it is.
Jump
really.
On there, follow along. The Boubet Sisters have a show this Saturday.
At the Cork Lounge, 7:30. Get there early, though, because it gets kind of packed.
It's the best.
Thanks
Thank
to Steve
you.
Schultz for his writing contributions to the show. And as always, we're everything to Pat Peach. Next week, a slew of films with the unfortunate release date of September 11th.
Oh,
see you then.
Yeah.